Hello and welcome to PodCastle in the Sky. In this episode, we will be looking at two sets of ghost story anthologies. On the one hand, a book called Tales of the Dead, translated by Sarah Elizabeth Utterson, based on an earlier French book called Phantasmagoriana. Also, we have an anime called Ayakashi Samurai Horror Tales, which is a set of three different stories, each told out over a couple of episodes by different creative teams. So, two combinations of horror stories, which are also traditional because, in the case of the translated work, it is allegedly based on older German stories, and in the case of the anime, it is based on some traditional Japanese tales. We'll see what's similar, what's different, and some miscellany as we proceed. I'm William.
I'm Amber.
I'm Jesse.
I'm Lily.
And I'm Tom.
Okay, you know what? I would actually like to ask everyone something about these properties, because these are horror stories, right? But did you find any of them scary? Because I did not.
I wouldn't say scary. I don't think
they push hard on atmosphere. They just push hard on the idea of ghosts intruding on people's lives.
Yeah, I don't know if maybe it's just the kind of conventions of what is horrifying today, but to me, like, the horror of somebody coming back from the dead for revenge and or a family member from the past unleashing a world of hurt on family members who had wronged them or are the young of the wrong, of the people who wronged, it just doesn't scare me all that much, you know. To me, it's more like, yeah, that seems appropriate. I mean
most of these older stories they're more morality plays than horror stories. I don't
necessarily agree with that, Amber. What I would say is, like, comparing this to, say, something like Turn of the Screw, which is relatively somewhat close in terms of, like, place and time of release and all these things, you know, closer than other things. What I would say is just, like, it's just not, the tone of these and style of these stories is really not horror. It's, like, Turn of the Screw maintains an active atmosphere of horror. Tales from the Dead does not. It is calmer.
Well, I sort of wonder if most of our modern horror conventions, what we consider scary, are more derived from the Gothic tradition and sort of the very kind of stark, emotionalized view of what's scary, the sort of Victorian aspect of scary. It's more macabre. Whereas, like I said, a lot of these older stories, I think, are more about kind of social conventions and the way they get twisted up and people not following them, coming back to haunt them and things like that. So it's more...
These also directly predate and influence those Victorian stories as well.
And also I would say Turn of the Screw, I mean, it's interesting you brought it up. It's sometimes argued as kind of like a second generation within 19th century horror. You can kind of post after that. Mm-hmm. So I think if you're looking at 19th century stuff to compare it to, I'd really point earlier, like the Castle of Otranto, the Anne Radcliffe stories, you know, like the Italian, The Mysteries of Udolpho, The Monk by Matthew Lewis. I don't know if any of these, admittedly, are ones people have read, but they'd be a little closer in time. Frankenstein, that would be one, okay?
Well,
they'd be familiar with.
I just wanted to mention that one thing that's really huge with horror nowadays is tension. You know, not just tension, but the unknown. In these stories, while, say, for instance, in the portrait story in Tales of the Dead, we don't necessarily know who is causing the dread or whatever. We don't get any of the, I don't know how to explain it, like, just the on the edge of the seat, don't go in the room, don't go in the room kind of stuff, you know what I mean? And with Ayakashi, we know throughout most of the tales, except for, I guess, the final one, what the horror is, you know, it's just more along the lines of, like, watching the horror commit horrible acts, you know, that's the horror, not necessarily trying to figure out the why behind it, you know what I mean?
You know that final story in the anime? I didn't actually find it very scary, and actually it was the story that I liked the least, mostly because the main character, the protagonist, was this, like, hyper-competent know-it-all. I could never actually buy that he was in trouble. like he always knew everything, and he always pulled out the one trick that would defeat the bad guy or whatever.
The one story of all the ones we're discussing here that kind of spawned his own franchise. It was sufficiently popular enough to have an entire series called Mononoke, not to be confused with the movie Princess Mononoke, because these kind of competent people who weave through the spirit world obviously have their place in terms of entertainment. The character's often been compared to Ginkgo, protagonist of Mushishi, and he has a similar kind of grasp and competency on the world he's entering.
Just to clarify, basically the story of the third story is this wandering peddler stumbles upon a wedding, the bride suddenly dies, bad omens, etc., demon monster cat starts murdering everyone, and they need to figure out basically what caused the demon murder cat to appear, and the only way, and our traveling peddler guy has this magical sword that'll kill the demon cat if it finds out the truth about what caused the tragedy to occur to begin with. And yeah, throughout the story, like Jesse was saying, he's constantly throwing out magical spells to ward off death, and he's sort of ensconced from the story in some way, even though he's the protagonist.
Like, yes, exactly. He's not part of the story. He's like more like an observer of what's actually happening to the people who are actually being affected, who are the family.
Yeah, it's slightly... I guess that's why he's almost sort of hyper-competent, is because he's not really that much of a character. Everyone around him is a character, but they just need some basically instigating element to force everyone to...
Okay, he's basically the Columbo. You know, he comes into a scene and he...
Exactly.
Yeah, we're watching the horror, you know, like, we're watching the baddies be sussed out by the detective. You know, his story is completely unimportant. What's important is that this family did this wrong to a young woman many years ago, you know, and we're trying to discover along with him what the truth of the badness is. Which, was anybody else really pissed off that the demon didn't get the one guy who really committed the sin? Like, revenge.
These horror stories.
Unfed.
A lot of them, like, don't they deserve to be punished? Like,
yeah.
Actually, I remember, like, on this one plot line, True Blood was going awful. What was it? This one, like, Iraq War veteran is, like, being hunted down by, like, a djinn, like an Arab, you know, fire demon. And they present it as so awful. But the reason he's being hunted down is because his unit massacred an entire village.
Oh, yes. Right.
But then they were treating it as like he was a victim. It's like, dude, they killed like these innocent villagers. Didn't they deserve to be hunted down by a demon?
One thing like with some horror stories is that there's a morality play going on, but it's not always presented as morality play that we should agree with. And while in the case in the True Blood, it may be a case where it's presented as, you shouldn't agree with this. And you might think, well, hang on, maybe I should. In Tales of the Dead, we have this story of this generational curse. And since we as a society, and even in, you know, the 18th century, people didn't necessarily believe that you should be doomed for the actions of your ancestors from the early Middle Ages.
Right.
I can definitely feel that while there's a moral logic to it, it's not a moral logic we're comfortable to. And I think a lot of horror is about exploring these kinds of lines, this kind of intractable morality, which we may not really ascribe to, and then just casting it in a horror frame.
In both Tales of the Dead, and many of the stories, and in Ayakashi, one of the biggest things was the vengeance is somewhat met. Does the haunter, you know, the ghost or whatever, have the right to continue haunting? At that point, it refuses to give up. Like in the first Ayakashi tale, for instance, does she have the right? The whole premise is kind of a framed story of the writer of the Kabuki play talking about how the ghost of Oya, is that her name? Continues to possibly haunt to this day any production of the play. It's very Macbeth in Japanese culture. You know, you have to honor her grave, or else perhaps if you create a movie or if you put on a play, she will come and cause disaster. So does she have the right to continue her vengeance, or should she let go and go to Nirvana or to whatever's next. And similarly, in, say, like, again, The Haunted Portrait, which I probably will bring up the most because it was the longest tale.
It was, yeah.
Does this young woman who was wronged hundreds of years ago get to continue to enact vengeance on anyone who walks under her portrait, for instance, just because she got fucked over by the family members years ago? Should she not at this point let go and go to heaven where she probably is supposed to reside? You know what I mean? Like, so maybe the horror is less what happens to people, but the fact that this being who is so angry just won't let go and thus causes disaster for people around them.
Well, you know, I like the first story in the anime. I actually liked how unexpectedly metafictional it got, because it was very clear about the story inside the story being a story. It's a play written by this one guy, and the thing he wrote about almost probably never actually happened, and the people in there probably never existed. And they make it very clear, but like this, the spirit of the story becomes its own reality, which is actually pretty unexpectedly metafictional, I thought, or some kind of, I don't know, was it a primetime anime? I'm not really sure.
I want to say it was one of the early Notanima shows. I'm going to check that right now. But, yeah, it was one of the very first Notanima shows, you know, first couple of years. I'm probably not pronouncing that correctly, but as viewers may be aware, it was a block of television carved out late at night to air more adult, serious anime aimed at an adult audience. And many classic series of the last decade have been from that block.
Can I just discuss real quick the anthology format of both? I thought was pretty cool. Like, obviously, like in novels, it's pretty common to have a bunch of writers come together with a common theme and write and create a short story book, you know, so you get a different form and style for each story. Although I do admit with Tales of the Dead, it's a little bit lost because it is a translation, and that always is, you know, when you get a translation, you're always going to have more of the translator's voice through each story. So it's hard to tell the difference in tone, for instance, and style. But in the anime, it was pretty fantastic how varied the animation styles were. I really loved, in particular, the first and the last. The second was pretty conventional, but the last in particular clearly was pulling from this Edo period artwork. And the first was, it was more of just like really stark. I really enjoyed the style of both. And also, again, the tone of both. Of all three were significantly different dependent on their directors and their artists, even to the, like, what sounds were used for, I don't know what you call it, action sequences and stuff like that. You know, like, it was really neat to just see three classical tales, you know, done in a completely different way. And I actually looked up the basis of all three tales just to see how close they came to the original. And I think the third might actually be sort of an original work based on just demon tales in general.
Yeah, the story, it was too much like traditional anime supernatural stuff. So
yeah,
I can kind of see that.
Yeah, yeah. But the first was actually based on, again, like a kabuki theater play that was, again, based on old legends. This legend of Oiwa, she may or may not have existed, but there is a grave out there that people do go to and offer their respect, again, if they plan on putting on this story. And the second one, it just follows along with a big tradition of demon slash goddess slash whatever, spirit of some sort falling in love with a human, which is a pretty classical Japanese idea. And then having to either give up part of themselves or be betrayed accidentally by the human into revealing their true form, which often causes death. And
a common side effect includes death.
Yes, yes, yes. Falling in love with humans could include feelings of melancholy.
Nausea.
Nausea.
Well, you know, in terms of story, the one I liked the most was actually the second anime story arc, the one where the guy falls in love with a goddess, mostly because the first, well, I already said why I didn't much like the third one, but the first one, it was clearly using a narrative style that doesn't follow like three act structure or whatever, and it was kind of weird to me that way because it kind of felt like based oddly or something. And also, besides that, it's like some of the cultural stuff. Like, I'm pretty sure there was like some kind of something about the relationships between the characters that's relating to their like samurai hierarchy or something, which I was not understanding. And there was also a lot of stuff that just appeared out of nowhere to me. I was like watching it and it was like, what the hell? The guy's mom is there? Where did she come from? And it was like, is this like, because they had to adapt it from the play and they had to stuff it all in or something, because I don't know. But
it's a five-act play, which is kind of, that might also be like the, maybe they were just compressing for time. And also the story in the anime goes quite a bit differently in some places than the play, in the sense of where people were being placed. Or for instance, I believe in the play, the girl who was feigning marriage to her half-brother, she knew of the half-brotherhood, and I don't think she ever actually consummated the relationship as they do in the anime. I think that it's more of just she gets herself killed for having even contemplated it.
Oh, actually, you know what? On that note, I'm not sure if you all noticed this, but all of the stories in both anthologies involve either love tragedies or some kind of horrific wrongdoings between men and women.
Mm-hmm.
It's more
and
obvious.
And family dynasty too. Yeah. That was huge.
Yeah. It's more obvious in the short stories because every single one of them, there's a marriage involved in some way. Like someone dies on their
and
way.
And inheritance too.
Yeah. Well, actually, that is actually one of the big things in 19th century literature. Inheritance and family relationships, there's like always these stupid, well, to us it sounds stupid, these twists about the long lost brother or something like that, which was more impactful to like Victorian audiences because, you know, their families are breaking down, their traditional large households were being trimmed down to like these nuclear families for the Industrial Revolution. So I can see why they were so anxious about families and so on, but the end result is it sounds kind of hokey and weird to us today.
I think it's also, like, to a certain extent, kind of rooting it in the past, what would be, for the readers, the past. Like, one of the great interests of Victorian Gothic is Catholic Europe, which they like portraying as more superstitious and irrational than they are. And Gothic has this unusual tension where either they're superstitious and irrational, and that's idiotic of them, or they're superstitious and irrational, and they're also completely correct. Like one of the first popular Gothic books, Castle of Otranto, and the more enlightened characters come up with a scientific explanation for a ghost sighting. It's very clear in the context of the story that, no, that's actually a ghost. There's also, on the one hand, validating Victorian Protestant prejudices, while at the same time poking fun at it a little. And there's that kind of element of remove here as well, because this is a translation of a French work, which reputes to be of a German work. Mm-hmm. I point this out because the very first Gothic book, Castle of Otranto, claimed to be a translation of an Italian work. But the original Italian work and the translator were fictional. That was complete nonsense. It was entirely created by a guy who published it under the pseudonym of the translator, Horace Walpole. A pseudonym because he's actually quite a well-known guy at the time. He's in government and all that, or his family was. So there's levels of remove. And this story in particular, like the first one, is like rooted in the goddamn Emperor Otto, the Holy Roman Empire. It's going all the way back in medieval times. You know?
Yeah. God, it took forever to get there, too.
Yeah. I know. It's kind of meandering. Yeah. Like, first you think it's about this one thing, and then this other thing, and then, okay, now we're finding out what the actual horror story was.
Yeah. Well, actually, I would sort of relate the... what's the name of the first story so that I can sound like I know what the fuck I'm talking about?
No, it's the one where the...
The family portraits. There we go. Okay, so the family portraits, which is the first story in the translation.
There's two portraits, actually.
Oh, yeah. I actually got a big feel for that. The first story in Ayakashi, which is, just a second, I'm going to look it up, Yatsua Kaiden. And you have a similar, like, where's the story going? Okay, these people are dead. Okay, wait, no. So it's going to be like, they're going to get vengeance only not, oh, wait, no. Now the wife is dead and this girl is dead and, you know, and then it all combines together and you find out, you get the, character seeking vengeance on the true killer, you know, at the end.
A lot of these older stories seem to put a lot of primacy in some ways in the supernatural elements. A lot of the times are sort of endnotes to kind of grounded dramas in the first half, less so in the story third of the anime. But because, I mean, the one Japanese horror story that I've read previously, which was a period translation, you know, the entire first half of it is this sort of social drama where basically there's peasants and they're suffering during a particularly bad harvest, and their lord is this sort of asshole who keeps ignoring their very mild protests to get aid. So eventually one of them runs out in front of the wagon of the shogun and hands him a petition, which is obviously a huge, even though he doesn't actually do, he's just handing the guy a petition within the social system of that time period, huge faux pas, and so his lord orders him to be executed, which he expected, but the lord is such a dick that he also executes his son and his wife, and he crucifies the two older ones, and then his wife vows vengeance on the lord. And that entire first half of the story, and it's, you know, probably like 30, 25 pages or something, it's just this really grounded, could easily be a historical account story, and then the second half shifts into this really crazy ghost revenge story, similar to Oyoash, where she's, you know, murdering mistresses and all this fun stuff. But so a lot of these older stories, and the first Tales of the Dead story does this, it takes a long time laying out the social dimensions and historical dimensions of these stories and grounding it in the real world, and then so by the time the really crazy supernatural stuff appears, you've been kind of grounded in that environment for a long time.
That is kind of interesting because I feel like that might just be a motif of horror in general. I can't think of very many horror stories even now, if they involve a supernatural element, that doesn't go out of its way to say, to make it like, this is any normal town where a shitty situation has happened in whatever family or whatever. Think Nightmare on Elm Street, right? It's just like normal kids who are fucking around, and for some reason this horrific being is after them in a normal town. And then you find out he was a horrific being in life too, and then the family decided to burn him to death rather than to seek out legal.
Yeah, a little different about these is there tends to be a cleaner break between the, like, it the modern horror stories tend to, you know, it's like a creeping progression of dread, whereas these tend to set the stage, and then everything really, all the pieces land at once.
There's also a horror story that, a modern horror story that begins as a pretty normal story and then pivots into the horror in a way that was completely unexpected. It actually sets up a completely unrelated plot.
Oh, this is your Hitchcock reference.
Yep, Hitchcock. Wait, it's Psycho.
Psycho.
I was actually going to say, like, his anthology series, Hitchcock Presents, but I couldn't resist saying Psycho in this context.
Of course, of course. Or then I was going to think, like, maybe The Birds.
Yeah, The Birds
are also good.
Arguably worse, too.
Birds also work.
Get
our Hitchcock mention.
Let me finish this one thought that I had, because I was thinking, yes, maybe then we've got this sense of, and when it comes to the European tales, I'm thinking like what they were based on less than the actual writers, because by that time we've got the Enlightenment and you've got a lot of, like, you know, like Will said, the sense that the supernatural is just as real as what we see in real life. You know what I mean? Like, the supernatural is always there. The supernatural is something that can get you if things go wrong. So if you have something grounded in reality at first, the supernatural isn't any less real. You know, it's just that these things happen.
Even in pieces that aren't necessarily horror of kind of the mid-19th century on, or I guess even earlier, Pushkin and stuff, where it is this kind of constant battle between the sort of romantic, emotional world of the supernatural and the rational sort of modern world. And there's this constant tension. And, I mean, a lot of these ghost stories do, I think, they are sort of less these ones because they're a little more traditional. But you go a couple decades later, and, yeah, I mean, most of the horror tales do end up being sort of exploring the friction between the modern world and the more romantic ideas of what might lay beyond that sort of sterile, rationalistic world.
Well, bring it back to these samurai stories, at least the second one anyway. I didn't really see as much of a divide between the old and the new. It was just kind of there. Like the, well, I guess, actually, no. I take that back. The second one, it was actually playing with a lot of like conventional horror cliches. I mean, the progression of it in the first episode was basically from one cliche to another. I mean, it opens with these horny teenagers going somewhere they're not supposed to be. And then, what was it? And then the guy, it's like a demon bride. And then it turns out that he's in love with a goddess or some crap. And it did strike me as maybe one of the reasons that I liked it the most was because it narratively it fit my preconceived notions of how horror stories work.
That could be, like, I don't know. Actually, to be honest, it was my least favorite, I think, because it felt, I wouldn't say cliche, but I've seen this story a lot. It, for some reason, the woman you find in the woods theme is a big one that's used across cultures. The dangerous woman that you don't even know is dangerous, that you fall for, she falls for you, and something, and this is forbidden, you know?
Yeah.
So when I was watching, I was kind of like, yes, oh, no, that's, that seems about right.
Yeah, I mean, that's always the challenge of, and I think for all its problems, what makes the third story really work is that it commits to something very interesting aesthetically, is, you know, we've seen a thousand different variations on all these stories by this point, because they are the progenitors of all their stories, you know, so it's hard to inject a lot of sort of, it's hard to inject something new and something kind of engaging into these stories, not because they're bad, but it's just, everything we've known over the past, you know, 200 years or whatever, is derived from these stories in a lot of regards. So it's you know, all these basic elements that have since been expanded and, you know, reversed and all those other, you know, it takes a certain amount of skill to take these really basic stories. And obviously, you know, a lot of them are, the first story of the anime is super famous. It's super famous for a reason. It's very, you know, the core elements of it just work. You know, creepy ghost bride, terrible death, all that stuff, tragedy and suicide, it's all very dramatic as a story, just works. But, you know, on a block by block basis, there's hundreds of these now, so it's thousands. That's always a challenge with going back to these. And I mean, I think what maybe the only problem with these is that what makes some folk stories really work is that they're so strange to modern conceptions, and particularly the morality of a lot of, you know, folk stories, and folk stories with a horror tinge are very sometimes even off-putting to modern readers or viewers, but that also makes them kind of exciting because they're just so strange.
This crossover there with the sort of like fairy tale mythos as well, just the very specific sort of morality and the extremity that often comes with that.
Yeah, I think, I mean, like I said, you know, these stories are familiar, and so I think, you know, it's interesting that I think you go back, but sort of the weirder components of maybe the even predecessors of these stories start to get into a territory that's kind of foreign and unknowable to us again.
You know, I want to go back really quick to the idea of it, the, all of the stories being about kind of family drama. I find it fascinating to me, like, just how important it, you know, the family dynasty is back in the day. You know, like, every single story is about, like, inheritance or, as mentioned before, love or betrayal or the destruction of an entire, you know, line.
Dynasty.
Yeah. Which is the ultimate revenge, to have no one to carry on the family line, to see it, you know, crumble to dust. And I don't know, I find it interesting that anywhere where family lines are important, the horror of losing everything is, like, used as, like, the ultimate, you know, shitty ending, you know?
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's the thing. I mean, we don't really, today we don't, you know, the threat of your family just vanishing from existence is not, even though, it's, I mean, it's, you know, it's possible. You could just, you know, not keep a name going or something like that, but...
Well, you don't see the fear now.
We don't prioritize that legacy.
Well, there's another thing to bring up, that the people writing the horror stories are the people who actually care about having family dynasties. The
good point.
The
yes.
upper class, the aristocrats. I don't really think the average peasant would care who cares on,
why
cares
this
on their family line. Like, I think a lot of them don't even have surnames. But, like, it's an overarching
yeah,
that's a good
obsession.
Point. Like, when we talk about, like, 19th century Irish Gothic fiction, it's almost exclusively Protestant, because it's generally people from the upper class of society. People went to Trinity, or people like Charles Maturin, who had a very good position as an Anglican curate, which he completely blew because his book was controversial. And they're often specifically about these extremely upper class fears, especially as Anglo-Irish authors living during the age of an emerging Catholic middle class, they felt a little threatened and isolated in a society where they were nonetheless at the very top.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Yeah, I would say the primarily thriving modern social anxiety regarding family connection is more just about, like, emotional distance and alienation in the modern day. I would I have personally encountered that today you do still run into people who have that very oddly traditionalist anxiety of, like, believing in the idea of a family line that must be maintained and kept strong, and that they're afraid of it going out. It's a really weird thing, but I have experienced it.
Well, I mean, I sort of get it on some level, because, I mean, it sort of plays with the idea of the more personal idea of non-existence. Like, I don't know, like, one day, this is really morbid thought, but one day we'll all be dead.
Mm.
And,
sure.
Mm. We'll all, one day you all will be dead.
But we'll
Sorry,
all have graves. And, you know,
I have, I found my sparkly vampire, so you guys do
yeah.
the thing. Okay.
But,
so.
You'll still be dead, though. You'll just be a vampire.
Well, plan to be a cyborg, but okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'll put my brain in a robot spider, so it'll be fine. But
singularity will also happen. Anyway, but continue, please.
But you know,
I'm going, like, to ascend into another plane of existence.
But if you go to historical graveyards and stuff, like, in a lot of cases, like, no one knows who those people are, and no one ever will.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's kind of crazy. Like, you know,
The idea of being forgotten about overall is still scary.
Yeah, just completely forgotten about by the entire universe. Like, that's, you know, that's sort of, there's a profundity to that. So I think that's probably where that comes from, and where that can maybe still work for a modern audience.
You know, I think that you are right. We've just kind of, we've moved away from this idea that it's your family line that remembers you, that, you know, or your family, if to be part of a still living family line means that you are in some way still remembered or still living. And we've moved more towards this very individualistic idea of how to be remembered. You know, it's not so much the family. It's, frankly, I think nowadays we've moved on to this idea that you have to get, like, other people to know you exist in the world.
Yeah.
You know, how fame has kind of blossomed into the be-all, end-all in some way. To have someone retweet your tweet, for instance, or whatever.
Mm-hmm. have a Wikipedia page with a picture.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so the modern horror story is like what? Not having... Only had like zero followers on your Twitter.
Yeah, can you imagine like the creepy music like of like say Joe or Sam like checking his Twitter account again and again and again, and no one follows him.
You know, you say that as a joke, but Black Mirror did that as a serious plot line.
Oh,
so I think you're onto something there.
I have got to see more Black Mirror. But yeah,
that was the Michael Schur and Rashida Jones episode.
Yeah, it was.
Then it is kind of, well, to be honest, with social media in general, and I know I have been sadly subject to this too, it's always kind of a little bit sad when you make a comment on even Facebook where you're surrounded by supposedly friends and no one likes your comment, you know? Like, if no one likes your comment, are you even real? You know, are the words that you say even important?
If a Facebook comment falls in the woods.
Exactly. So, in a sense, I am closer to falling to dust because other people refuse to acknowledge me in the broader world, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So
it's not quite everyone being taken out by the plague, but it's something.
Yeah. It's something. And it's not a ghost killing your whole line. It's true.
I also think that the redefinition of like of connection and the anxiety over connection, I think there's an intersection there with like the cultural evolution of the notion of a family and what a family is.
Well, I feel like we're also kind of moving away a little bit from that particular familial connection fear was really, really big, I think, from, say, like around the 50s onward until probably, I would say in the aughts, it started to kind of back away as something that occurs, maybe just because culture now has shifted to the point where it's okay for your dad to hug you now, you know? Well, you know, I've never had this social angst of having a mother or a father who wasn't as close to me as I thought would be best for me, as opposed to, say, someone in the 70s who would be reading something like a modernist book about how they just never had that kind of connection that they feel that
lot,
they are.
A lot of dad problems.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
yeah, you know, the other thing is, like, hierarchy isn't really, I mean, obviously, it still exists and is quite profound in some ways, but the sort of rigid hierarchical structures that you find in stories like this don't mostly exist anymore. And because a lot of these stories, you know, even, you know, I mean, the last one, I guess, of the anime or the one I was talking about earlier, which, I mean, that one's earlier. The one I read previously is interesting because it is from a peasant perspective, but the kind of morality element there is still kind of how society should be organized and how the hierarchical structure should not, you know, the lords should be acting in a way that is proportional to what happens.
What was that story called?
Oh, God, I can't remember anymore. I think it's somewhat famous. It was in a book about... It was in an academic book about peasant rebellions in Japan. So you might just Google that, because I think it is a somewhat... I think there's a bunch of different versions, but it was very interesting.
Well, you know, the when you talk about the hierarchical... the hierarchy between, say, even classes, or even a family, you know, not existing, we are really, truly in kind of a brand new era, just in the last, say... 90 years or so of the breakdown of a lot of the hierarchy after World War I in particular, and then the familial hierarchy breaking down as women's rights really took off and things like that. So, and I think that that is, again, what a lot of media explored between the 50s and the 90s in particular, you know, living in this brave new world where both your class and your place in a family does not matter anymore. You build your own idea of what it is. And now we're kind of starting to eke out of it a little bit where our placement in a family, for instance, really is determined by the people who are in the family. It has nothing to do with society's ideas of what a family member it should be a wife or a husband or whatever it should be. So I am really intrigued about what the next, you know, what our next horror stories are going to be. Not, you know, beyond just like the cycle of the zombies and the vampires and stuff like that. You know, what our new psychodramas of the family are going to be, or psychodramas of society are going to be.
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of it is...
What about Badaboo?
Yeah.
You do see a lot about...
This woman and a relationship with her emotionally troubled son. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the entire family unit. I thought I liked it.
But yeah, there's also a heavy investment, just like individualist psychology and...
Well, I think psychology and individual sexuality are the two kind of ones that get a lot... It follows, you know... was very much in that vein.
The Witch is a very, like, The Witch is in some ways very different from those, but there's some intersection as well.
I think The Witch, I think what was really interesting about The Witch is I think that the horror that they were really bringing out, aside from the fact that, actually it was a lot like what Will was talking about earlier with the Gothic stories that both poke fun at the Catholics, but also they were correct in their superstitions. They were right. Mm-hmm. It was the same thing with The Witch. You've got, like, us knowing that their societal structure was really fucked up, but at the same time in this movie, they were right. There was definitely witchery going on, and you definitely can talk to a goat and have him turn into Satan, and he will definitely help you write your name in the black book, you know, so...
I mean... Yeah, there's definitely the aspect of the witch to me is primarily about patriarchy. It's about patriarchy and why the witches are, you know, an outlet, a valuable outlet and or necessary in their presence.
That is a good point, but
that's also a bit like Days of Wrath. It's also about this kind of controlling father, the Danish movie from the 1940s, and he's, you know, paranoid, suspicious that people are witches, and he's also right.
Yeah,
but it's also their way to organize outside of his society control. It's actually really a common theme with witch stories to play on that kind of contention. By traditional witch stories, I mean like 20th century witch stories.
I do love that scene at the end of The Witch where Satan is like, "Do you want to live deliciously?" With like, and the way he lures her in is butter.
would you like the taste of butter? Well, I mean, butter is an absolute, like, complete indulgence at that point, especially.
Yeah, well, I mean,
like,
she's basically starving because her father chose to leave the settlement and start up something new. And it's an interesting tale because on one hand, the patriarchy is correct. There are some witches who are fucking up shit. But on the other hand, you're like, well, maybe it's okay for those witches to pound babies to pulp and wipe them all over their bodies. I mean, you know, it's like the one thing you get to do that's fun.
That's somewhat
close to what my feelings on The Witch are.
I mean, I think with that movie, it's mostly just, I think it's just enjoyable to kind of take period elements on their own terms, because that's something a lot of period movies fail to do.
You are because
people aren't
right.
People aren't really comfortable. I mean, we've talked about this previously, I think on one other episode, but it's hard to make sometimes accurate period characters sympathetic, and so you end up watering them down where they're just pre-naturally, you know, progressive or something. And so I think it's fun for a movie like that to take a chance and sort of engage with period characters on their own terms, and then obviously add this supernatural element into it that adds a little twist.
Well, I think that one thing, again, with period pieces, which in what we watched and read, like bringing it back a little, it is just absolutely known that the supernatural elements do exist. They are there. They are happening, you know?
Yeah,
and
Take it for granted by that.
Yeah, exactly. In the modern world, even in stuff like the Babadook, which seemed pretty clear that this thing was real, you will always have the argument presented that, oh, it was all in their head. And in the story themselves. And in fact, I had a small discussion with someone online about The Witch, and their argument...
I was there for that discussion.
Oh, you were there for the discussion? Because their argument was that it was all in the daughter's head. And my position was, in the movie universe, this was all real. You know, we can take it all as a metaphor, and we can do the same thing in the stories that we watched, you know, in Tales of the Dead and in Ayakashi's, like, as was mentioned, their morality tales. But in the worlds of the stories themselves, the supernatural elements are absolutely real. Nowadays, it's really hard to find something that is both a morality tale and not presented either by the person who creates it as maybe it's real, maybe it's not, or other people outside of the story don't just take it for granted. They say,
And I mean, I think we're seeing a resurgence of explicitly supernatural horror. Because for a while, it was all like serial killers and torture and murder. Right. Fucking boring. But I think people are now starting to have it a little more fun and engage in, you know, more flights of fancy, so to speak.
Yeah.
But, well, I would have two things to say. Firstly, that I think it reflects to a certain extent the theological worldview. Like, Tales of the Dead is from a strongly Christian context. Whether it be Protestant or Catholic, there's a general agreement that, you know, God exists, angels exist, the afterlife exists, and so possibly ghost stories can exist and be consistent with that theology. And likewise with the Japanese stories, at least the older, authentic ones, they're from an era when Japan was a syncretic but religious society. Like, there's the traditional Shintoism, and then, you know, Buddhism would also be imported from China, but then just incorporated with the existing Japanese beliefs. And while there was a diversity of opinion as to which was the correct way to approach these religions, people in Japan all generally agreed on the existence of these gods, these religious forces. While today we live in secular societies where, while most people identify as religious, they can be of many different religious denominations. And of course, a lot of people, even religious people, downplay the significance of the supernatural. My other point, however, was even when dealing with the supernatural today, we often deal with it in terms of the subconscious. And thinking of the film It Follows. Now, It Follows, the it is real for the purpose of the story, but the director said he based it on a dream, and it operates with a dream logic. So there's a direct connection to the subconscious. It's just literalizing the subconscious for the story. I think there's that element as well in modern supernatural. It's always tied to that kind of thing, or often tied to that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, returning to the whole naturalness of the supernaturalness in the older stories, I do remember this specific example in the story about the, what was it, the family portraits, when they're like finding out the backstory behind the cursed portrait. It turns out it happened because of this monk who cursed the founder of the family line. And no one remarked that medieval monks apparently are wizards who can curse people. I was like, what? What the hell?
Magic
powers?
I personally take that for granted. You don't think all monks are secretly just harboring all the magic and they don't let us know about it?
Must be doing something like in there.
As a former Catholic, I just thought that was a given, guys.
Same, Amber.
Although I should also point out that Protestants, particularly in the field of Gothic fiction, felt like they downplayed supernatural elements in terms of reason. So there's always that tension as well. That's why they loved overemphasizing the supernatural elements in Catholic countries. I realize I'm harping on that a lot, but I've read a lot about it, so I just keep coming back to it.
I wanted to step back because Jesse at one point said, I have a movie to mention, and then we all kind of talked over him.
Oh, those ones. Oh, well, actually, you know what?
We've been doing this for a while, and we're still really bad about talking over each other.
Yeah, just to bring it back to 21st century horror, I actually have two movies that came to me. The first is, what the hell was that movie? The one with the kid who befriends like this female vampire, this Scandinavian movie?
Let the Right One In.
Yes, that one. Because the entire thing of the story was this kid's isolation, and that's how he became friends with a vampire, because he was bullied, because his parents were divorced, because his mom didn't have time for him. And that's how he became the assistant to basically a serial killer.
Yeah, we get this framing shift from child love story based on mutual alienation to he is vulnerable to her, like, exploiting him and using him as her puppet.
Right, sorry. So that's not actually a kind of story that you can get with a 19th century setting.
Right.
But the second kind of, the second movie I was going to mention was actually Pulse, the Japanese horror movie. Mm. Which is basically about the horror of the internet, not about internet trolls or anything stupid like that, but basically about how how lonely the internet is, and
right.
how everyone on the internet is alone, and throughout mm-hmm. the movie they're basically killed by their loneliness, which is actually pretty freaking scary.
That's actually do you know how many, like, freaking articles I've read over the last 5 years of isolation being a killer? I mean, usually in the sense of greater possibility of heart problems and blah, 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 but, like, still.
Yeah, no, that's definitely a big thing that I've seen a lot of, and that does tie this all in to, stuff we talked about earlier with, we talked about Black Mirror, and we talked about a prevailing anxiety of alienation in modern-day society. Ties in together with the role of the internet in human interaction.
There's also that movie about unfriending people. What the hell was that?
Unfriended, wasn't that actually called Unfriended is not about unfriending people. Unfriended is about teens bullying each other and it coming back to haunt them.
Wait.
I definitely watched a horror movie about Facebook, and Facebook or Twitter or something turned people into zombies. And it was called something like Unfriended.
Oh my god.
It was a real movie.
I did not see that.
It was kind
That's
of dumb.
Amazing.
Unfriended is the one where
social media turns people into zombies, and then they started attacking. Literally, like George Romero type zombies.
Yeah, that's actually true of a lot of like horror movies about the internet. It's basically about how bad the internet is, but it doesn't really take. Most of the time, it's reactionary. It doesn't actually take the perspective of the people using the internet.
Yeah, and it's basically treating the internet as a, like, nigh-magical entity that it was treated like in a lot of 90s media when it was first coming on the scene.
That Sandra Bullock movie, what was it?
The Net.
Oh, my God.
So classic.
You've
the
got
Net
mail.
And hackers, man. The internet is magic.
Unfriended is actually smarter and better than you would think. The one that's like a Skype call with a ghost haunting them. It's not... I would call it good, but it's way better than it looks.
Well, actually, you know what? I just remembered something. I think Tom was mentioning it before, about how horror movies start as normal and become horrific. In the beginning, they're almost aggressively normal, that it's happy friends, happy family, and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I have two exceptions I can name. The first is Dog Soldiers, which is about British soldiers on military exercises who are attacked by werewolves, who are under siege by werewolves, which was pretty friggin' cool. And
I was actually going to see it because it's Neil Marshall's best reviewed film.
Oh, really?
Of course, people know Neil Marshall now for, like, Game
soldiers.
Of Thrones and stuff.
Thanks, guys.
You're welcome, Amber.
Well, the second horror movie, which really counts as horror or more as science fiction, is Attack the Block. Because, how often does a horror movie start with, like, hoodlums and, like, drug dealers and stuff? It's always, like, suburban families or whatever. But this one, the perspective of the underclass.
Yeah, but is that really starting as abnormal? Or is, like, does it just start with, like, hoodlums? Or does it start with hoodlums meeting aliens? Which does it begin with?
It does start with the hoodlums. Actually, I think it starts with hoodlums mugging someone.
Yeah.
So it's
different because they're like not typical horror protagonists.
Yes.
But it still follows the rule of beginning in the real world, beginning normally, and adding the supernatural element later in the film.
But it is very much a different status quo than.
Yeah, it's a different status quo, but it's different in a different way than Dog Soldiers was different. Is what I'm saying. That makes sense.
On that note, as we talked about earlier, you have The Witch, where The Witch starts with the character's banishment, and within the first 10 minutes, the baby has been abducted and ground into bloody paste. It's a very... it dives right into the fucked upness.
I just thought of a third example. It's a Nick Cage movie, but don't hold that against it. It's what the hell was that? Where he was a crusader? Season of the Witch.
Right, Season of the Witch.
Yes, Season of the Witch. Right.
Because first off, the prologue is about a witch being executed, but the majority of the opening action is Nicolas Cage and I forget the guy's name, but anyway, him and his friend
Ron Perlman.
Yeah, there you go.
Or is it the guy in Misfits?
Yeah. They're basically like these crusaders massacring heretics, which is totally not the typical horror story opening. And then find out they stumble across actual witches. So that's kind of a thing. Like throughout the first half of the movie, they're pretty sure they're just killing normal people, just heretics. And then the second half of the movie, they find like actual evil to fight against.
That reminds me, I think, of one of the old-time classic films. Not in the sense of being a classic film, because it's not. But classic in the sense that it randomly adds a supernatural element in the middle, and it didn't necessarily need it, but it completely changes the kind of movie it is, which is From Dusk Till Dawn.
Oh, yes.
Which is a movie, it begins, it's a straight gangster movie. It's guys, you know, robbing stores, blowing up stores, you know, holding people at gunpoint. They're rushing to get to the border to Mexico to avoid the federales. And then they cross the border to Mexico. They hit up a bar, and the bar is actually a home for vampires who kill people. So it suddenly becomes a vampire movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I don't like From Dusk Till Dawn anymore, but I would argue that the vampire half is way more fun than the first half.
I think everybody would argue that.
But I think it's just really bizarre because it's a movie that completely pivots. Like, the thing with a lot of the horror movies, because firstly, you know, the horror is advertised, but secondly, and let's be honest here, most of the time, the stuff before the horror is kind of boring.
Mm. Yes,
you don't really want to
yes.
see a whole movie of the happy suburban family having no problems. Mm. But this, gangsters, heist, you could have had a whole movie like that.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, when I had the massive amount of luck to not have seen From Dusk Till Dawn until I was in college, or even really know the premise of it. So when I was watching with a friend of mine who was stunned and disgusted in the fact that I had yet to watch it, I could tell she was watching me. Like, she was doing the thing. So I'm like watching what I think is a pretty typical Tarantino-esque flick, you know, with the family and the murders and the heists and yada yada, and then vampires. And I remember saying multiple times, "What the fuck?" You know, like, you know, movies need to pivot just into the wild. Like, it's one thing. I mean, maybe not so much that it becomes cliche, but it's one thing to have like a Shyamalan-esque twist, you know. It's another thing to have your entire premise just flipped on its head, you know, wherein we were trying to, you know, solve, we were gangsters getting monies and going across the border. Oh no, vampires, you know, like, yeah, no, it's just rare. It's rare to come, to have filmmakers be brave enough to just go, we were doing a whole movie about this family who was meeting up at Thanksgiving, and there's some tension between the moms and the mom and the daughters, and actually fairies. So, you know,
substantial tonal and content shifts like that are really interesting, and I'm a big proponent of them. On that note, I was recently watching a movie. It was awful. Like, I don't recommend it. It was called Nightmare Man. It's real bad, but. There's this very interesting thing where, so late in the movie, we have the plot twist that the person who's trying to kill the female lead was hired by her husband, and that's played up. And never mind that. How about the fact that we find out that she's actually possessed by a demon? Like, that just, it comes out of nowhere that she's actually has a demon inside her, and the demon kills the husband, and the last like 20 minutes are really fun. It's awesome.
Wait. Wasn't there a soap opera in the 90s? Was it, I can't remember which one it was. But
are you talking Passions? Because Passions.
Whichever one, that suddenly had demon possession in it.
Oh, it was definitely Passions.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
That show was fucking insane.
It was.
So...
Okay.
I think someone's obligated to mention Baywatch Nights.
What?
Baywatch ran for like 10 years or something. Then they spun it off into a 2-season show called Baywatch Nights. And in the second season of that show, it became like the X-Files, supernatural elements.
What? I did not know that. Oh my
Yeah.
Oh, Amber, you didn't know about that. It was amazing.
Nobody watched it and it was canceled. But it was like a complete bizarre sudden pivot into the supernatural from a franchise which was mostly known for people running around wearing swimsuits at the pool.
Oh,
my God.
At
the water or whatever.
So it was supposed to be the same world, like by day.
Oh, yeah, same continuity. Yep. Like David Hasselhoff was in it and he was playing his Baywatch character.
Oh my God! That's
but now he was investigating like werewolves and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Beechcraft.
Well, just slightly older TVs. Very people take TV a little more seriously now, but they did some weird spin-off shit back in the day.
Yeah, I mean, Family Matters is obviously a classic example. You know, you create a spin-off TV series that's meant to be a realistic depiction of an African American working class family, and then you add Steve Urkel, and the rest is, you know, history.
What? Were you not a fan of Stefan Urkel? Because
look, to be honest, I never saw the show, and I only knew of it growing up because it was referenced on The Simpsons.
Oh, really?
I had no idea what Homer was talking about. I'm not even sure if it even aired yet.
I was young enough to have been pretty big on TGIF.
Yeah,
so
I watched so much of that.
Oh, my God. I watched such shit back then, but I loved every
minute
of it.
I think we have officially hit the threshold of, okay, our episode is long enough. And
you're probably right. We're bringing in like...
out of stuff to talk about.
Yeah, okay, all right. So
when you reach Urkel, we're ready to wrap up.
Reach peak final Urkel.
Peak Urkel. When Urkel is mentioned, it is known that a podcast must end.
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say, so final thoughts on Tales of the Dead and Ayakashi?
I would say I like Tales of the Dead more than Ayakashi because, like, basically I was lukewarm towards two out of three of them, whereas I only kind of liked the one I actually liked. Whereas Tales of the Dead, even though a bunch of the stories in there didn't actually have anything much of a plot, it was just basically listing stuff that happened, I thought it was actually more interesting, just historically, just to see what people were scared about back then.
Mm-hmm.
I think Tales of the Dead benefits from the general anthology aspect of, like, the more stories you have, yes, there will be a wide range of quality, so, you know, have things that, you know, they're accessible to people. I found it pretty interesting, and, like, the family portraits one especially is actually, I was, like, emotionally invested and affected by the end of it. So, yeah.
So, I actually enjoyed both of them fairly equally for the presentation of stories. I actually never knew, you know. I do admit to liking what I read of Tales of the Dead more than Ayakashi. I think more just because there was more time to really lay out your premise in the written word. While Ayakashi, I feel... I forgot to mention. I felt like, first of all, the stories were kind of squeezed, you know. I felt like they needed more time to really flourish with some of them. But also, I felt like it was weirdly presented. Like, did anybody else get kind of thrown off with the opening? Like, that opening was really...
Hip-hop. Yeah.
The hip-hop opening for these old Japanese tales, one of which was a kabuki theater opening. And they had a mention that you could get the album on Sony Records. Like, just kind of
what?
The Sony Records thing is extremely common. I mean, if you watch a lot of anime, they almost always have a reference like that right after the opening credits. I think it's sometimes edited in Western releases, but it's every single show from that period.
I absolutely did not know that, probably because I haven't seen... But still,
trust
me.
I mean, I have it like burned into my brain like this. Something, something, something. Sony Records. It's just like, I can wake up to it.
So, while I did enjoy Ayakashi, and I would really, especially just because the variants in animation style and the stories themselves are pretty neat, I would recommend Tales of the Dead more. Especially if you're into 1700s, 1800s lit, you know. So if you're reading like a bunch of Austin right now, go read some Tales of the Dead, you know.
Mm-hmm. I don't really have any strong feelings on either, but they're cool. Yeah, it's pretty much it.
You're making me want to go back to reading Jane Austen, and I can't afford that time wise right now.
we might find an excuse for Austen at some point in this thing. You know, I feel someone has to mention Northanger Abbey, right?
Oh, of course! I cannot believe nobody has mentioned that book.
Okay. There, we said it. We can put it on the record. We said it, so no one can accuse us of not saying it. Okay, my feelings about the two works is, well, I'd always really found Ayakashi quite interesting. I was the one who suggested that we cover it, mostly for the reasons that have already been covered. It's got a certain variety of style and tone and different kind of executions to the stories. I've always particularly liked the third one the best, because that was also spun off into a series, as I mentioned. But I really like the visual style and this kind of anime-style story. But I had not heard at all of Tales of the Dead before we did this. It was completely new to me. And I thought it was interesting, partially in kind of trying to situate it in terms of the development of Gothic fiction, which is something of some interest to me, but also the stories themselves, which, while they presented very straight, they had an element of unintentional humor, like a character offhandedly observing, oh yes, that story is definitely about my dead sister. You know, there was kind of all these building tragic sagas can often have an element of humor to them, is my point there. Oh, but even in spite of that, I thought Tales of the Dead was an interesting and very brief read. And now brief is admittedly convenient in this day and age with all the content one can get. And you can get the whole thing for free off Gutenberg. So, you know, can't do worse. I would recommend both of them.
Actually, you know, I forgot to mention about Tales from the Dead. I think like 2 out of the 5 stories, maybe 3, they start off, this is a real thing that happened to a friend of mine. It's like I was like, they actually said that? Like, what the hell? But I guess it wasn't a cliche back when it was written.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's part of like the oral tradition, is it not? Yeah, I mean, extending all the way to, you know, the campfire stories and how they're like in those terms.
I mean, they claim to be German stories, but I haven't seen anything to indicate that there really are German stories that this French collection was based on.
Right.
But who's the friend of the friends? The friend of the friend of the person who wrote the alleged German original? I don't know.
That's a good question. Mm. Oh, damn you. Now I need to know.
No, you might as well. I mean, we might as well include it if we can get the information whether an original German exists. I didn't find any evidence of it.
I actually didn't either when I was looking around. Like, so weird.
Okay, so next time on PodCastle in the Sky, we are covering the movie Princess Mononoke, and we are comparing it to the Michael Mann movie Last of the Mohicans. Not the novel, the movie. Definitely the movie. The modern versus the traditional, the indigenous versus the colonizers, that's what we're coming up against. And
both in the 90s.
Yes.
Sorry.
And until next time, I am Jesse.
I'm Amber.
I'm Lily.
And I'm William.
Right.
All right. Bye!
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Good luck.
Have a good day.
Right, I'll see you guys.